Conversations in Frailty. The podcast for Derbyshire clinicians.
Hello, and here we are already on episode 4, Depression, of these Conversations in Frailty. At long last, I'm actually looking out of my window into the garden at some sunshine on the spring blossom. So, welcome if you're listening in for the first time, and of course to all the regular listeners out there, whether you're listening in on the DCHS YouTube or you found me on Spotify. Do keep spreading the word to colleagues if you're finding these helpful, and leave any reviews of any feedback or any future requests for topics you'd like to hear about. So for those of you who haven't listened before, I'm Sarah Morris, GP by background and working in Derbyshire's Community Health Service Trust. I'm having a great time roaming around the county to interview experts on all sorts of conditions affecting our older patients with frailty and hopefully providing you with some useful updates, tips and new insights. So in this chat today, I have the double bonus of talking to one of our consultants in old age psychiatry, Nick Long, together with Josh Carney, clinical lead nurse working with him. We start out reflecting a bit about how changing self-perception in the elderly influences how depression presents, and think about the most useful ways we can access psychological support for the housebound population, and listen out for some useful pros and cons around different SSRIs. And we end by touching on the tricky area where thoughts about life naturally coming to an end can overlap with potential suicidality and where to refer for advice when we're concerned. So I'm delighted to have two interviewees with me today, and I'll pass over to you and get you to introduce yourselves, please.
Hi, yeah, I'm Dr. Nick Long. I'm a consultant in old age psychiatry and I work across North Derbyshire in the Older Adults Crisis Services.
And hi, I'm Josh Carney. I'm a clinical lead nurse and non-medical prescriber, and I primarily work in the High Peak and North Dales.
Great. Thanks for joining me today. So what we were going to talk about today was mainly depression in the thinking, particularly about the frail elderly population, as this is a conversation in frailty. And I thought maybe just as an opener, just some thoughts really about what are the risk factors for depression in this population that we'd think about particularly.
So I often think about this cohort and go back to some psychological theory from Erikson, who's a Swedish psychologist, I believe, who described life as a series of challenges. So in early life, there's things like autonomy versus shame, for example, or generativity versus stagnation. And his description of older life, or later life, was integrity versus despair. And I find that quite a helpful concept around the notions of depression, and when you see that in older people, those that manage to maintain an integrity looking backwards but also looking forwards about sense of self, sense of purpose, and continuing to evolve that and maintain it, tend to be more robust against the challenges of later life than those who perhaps have that more despairing position. And then when you start to think about the challenges, so retirement often sounds positive and great, doesn't it? Still 30 years away for some of us, but often it's difficult because you've lost decades worth of purpose and role.
Yeah.
And you know, those in vocational jobs particularly, it's part of who you are and your identity. You've also got relationships that you then return from a working life or a life that you've been giving on to others back into a family home with a partner often, and that changes the dynamic. Not necessarily always for the better. You've also then got physical illness, so all that time spent looking forward to these glory years, actually when you hit the sixth decade, seventh decade and so on, often a lot of people become unwell in somehow, and that really changes what you can do and your perception of yourself. You've then also got the fact that that's happening to all those around you, and so they become ill or they die. And especially when you start to get to know people in their eighth, ninth decade, they'll often describe that everybody's gone. Their spouse is long gone, their friends have died. And they start to become lonely, they start to become isolated, and those lengthy relationships that are quite sustaining and often might be balancing and containing have also gone. which sounds quite a bleak view of aging, doesn't it? But I suppose a lot of people have that challenge.
They have, they've got the loss of function, they've got the bereavement, the isolation, changing role, a lot, and the physical illnesses.
So then you come back a little bit to what I was saying at the start with Erickson and integrity versus despair underneath that. Those who perhaps are struggling with integrity, that's where that challenge of despair comes in. And the, you know, those are big, I think, sort of psychological and social risk factors for that. Something we've learned through COVID, I think, is that there is actually a biological impact of isolation. We probably knew it already, but actually it makes us unwell to be alone. We're social animals, and it creates a stress, a chronic stress that does drive illness and depression, anxiety, that very much in the fore. You've also got the risks with substance misuse. Let's not forget that Paul McCartney's just turned 80, Mick Jagger's 82, I believe. So, you know, we're talking about that group that we shouldn't really feel surprised, maybe use alcohol and sometimes even drugs. So you've got all of those other things, plus then you've got the accumulated burden of vascular disease. So subcortical vascular disease in particular confers increased risk of depression, resistance to treatment. Heart disease, increased risk of depression, resistance and complications of treatment. Diabetes.
Hence we're supposed to screen all, in primary care, screening all our chronic disease patients for this. And figures I found said, rough figures, about in terms of prevalence, 10% of the over 65s and 20% in the care home cohort. Would you think that is consistent with what you see?
I don't often go into the care homes. In the crisis team that I work in, a lot of people we see are at home. I think following on from what Nick's saying, you see a lot of the sort of biopsychosocial elements to people of the isolation, the loneliness, the living in sort of poverty. You know, you sometimes think of an elderly population as sort of, you know, they paid off the mortgage, living in a nice house, have lots of money. But what we're seeing more and more, I suppose, is people going into more sort of living in a poverty, living in houses that aren't maintained. So you see a lot more of that. And there are still, you still people coming through that sort of live in sort of nicer and more wealth. But a lot of what we deal with has a lot more sort of complexity to it. So a lot of sort of our involvement with people is more around sort of the non-medical approaches to working with them and trying to support them to, I suppose, live a healthier life rather than just sort of focusing on sort of depression as a condition per se. I think there's a lot higher prevalence of depression in care homes. You probably go into care homes more, Nick.
Yes. And it's my rule of thumb in my mind about prevalence is always about 1 in 4 in the community setting, and then 1 in 4 again in the care home setting. I suspect it's probably higher in the care home setting because there's a lot of undiagnosed depression. Depression and dementia are very often comorbid, but very difficult to pick out. How do you tell the difference between apathy, despair, depression sometimes? Whereas I suppose within the care home population, often there's a lot of, you know, sort of quite significant cognitive impairment, and then the depression comes alongside, and that may manifest as agitation, irritability, or could just be withdrawal, often mistaken for delirium, or it's just their dementia, which would be a phrase I'd eradicate from.
Yeah, which just sort of brings us on. I was going to say next, how do we think of depression presenting, I suppose, in the elderly compared to in what we see in, you know, say in general practice in the young adult population? You know, Josh, you're talking about the kind of, you know, potential, well, I guess, self-neglect that might be going on if there's a lot of poverty and the sort of overlap with the agitation and things.
So I've come from a background of working in sort of adult acute care and then sort of transitioned into sort of older adults. So I've worked with people from all age ranges, really, except for children, with mental health conditions. So you see sort of a lot of adults present as a very sort of typical depressive presentation, a lot of the biological symptoms that you see. I think with older adults it's a lot more complex, and I think that's where it needs more sort of advanced assessment, I suppose, is that you've got sort of, you can look at your core depressive symptoms, but you can't look at that without looking at the context of somebody's life and where they've come from, the traumas that they've had throughout their life, especially with the population that we get now, with the years that they've lived through, they've experienced probably a lot more trauma, which is going to be impacting on how they present now. And especially as Nick was saying earlier about as you get older, you start seeing, I suppose, more loss around you, the social connections you have start to sort of fade away. And, you know, if you just used a sort of simple sort of rating scale for depression, a lot of old adults probably tick a lot of those things off when you're rating somebody. It's not necessarily to say that they're depressed as such, but the circumstance and situation that they find themselves in as they get older leads them to have a lot of potential depressive symptoms. So I suppose the complexity that we see is, yes, medication's a part of it, especially with things like frailty, having occupational therapy sort of input and assessment, I think, is quite required in an older adult population. You look at sort of remotivating people and getting people engaged again. You can't do that without looking at someone's physical ability and what they can practically manage.
So do you often see it as a functional decline, you know, in terms of an initial presentation, that they're just struggling to carry things out because of their depression, rather than declaring, I feel low, I feel sad?
I think there can be, and that sort of subjective low mood is often less prominent than it might be in working age adults, for example. So then, whether that's, as you said, that kind of it's affecting them a bit more functionally and they're not verbalising it, or whether it's sort of a slightly sort of generation based stigma, or, you know, I'm not going to say I'm low, I'm not going to say I'm depressed, but here I am, I'm not enjoying any of my usual activities, I've lost all of my energy, I can't concentrate, and I'm waking up at 4 o'clock every morning. So sort of identifying particularly those kind of core biological features, I tend to find that there's a greater emphasis on those in the elderly rather than the sort of more cognitive, you know, sort of subjective low mood, excess guilt and so on, although that's far from saying that they're not there. I think the other two kind of key presentations to watch out for are depression with psychosis, which can quite often unravel quite quickly, is associated with a lot of risk. It's probably, I think, the males over 70 with the first presentation of psychosis in the context of depression is, I would say, the group most likely to end their lives out of the entire cohort that we see in mental health. And they're the ones that I lose sleep over. And we're doing some work within the Trust about sort of trying to improve pathways for access and awareness in that regard. Agitated depression has sort of gone out of fashion a little bit as a sort of term.
Yeah, we don't hear about.
I don't really know why. I mean, it seems quite a common element. So rather than that sort of loss of energy, you've got people who present with this kind of listless driving anxiety almost, and it often gets mistaken for generalised anxiety disorder as a result, and people sort of go down that pathway. But underneath it, they've got those other features of depression. Things are slipping away, and very often they respond better to treatment that's geared in that, you know, the direction of depression, rather than trying to consistently work on it with an anxiety line.
And if we're trying to unpick it, would you, you know, in sometimes in the community we use these sort of depression scales, you know, in an adult we might be using the PHQ-9 or whatever. Would you recommend any geriatric-specific scales if we're trying to unpick this, or would you steer away from that? What would be your take on that?
In an area I find those useful, I suppose, just thinking a little bit about some of the dynamics that I think work in primary care as well as secondary care now, where you have doctors almost at the top of a triangle, don't you, or a pyramid, where lots of people are going out doing assessments and coming to you and asking your opinion remotely, and that tacit knowledge that you get with being someone with somebody you don't have. So sometimes if it's not clear, there can be useful differentiators, because all those rating scales are based on essentially the underlying diagnostic criteria around pervasive subjective low mood, anhedonia, loss of energy, concentration, early morning awakening, hopelessness, worthlessness, success, guilt, etc. So I suppose it helps kind of focus people in on that kind of assessment, such that then that helps bring in the wider picture. We do also use the Cornell scale for depression and dementia, which has got a carer-rated element that can help try and unpick a little bit more
Because that is a very common problem, isn't it? The dementia, yeah. depression overlap, I think, in working out what's what. Yeah. Great. And then moving on, what we can actually do about it. You mentioned just the kind of holistic approach, but I think one question to bring to you both is really one, I think, difficulty we have is the guidance seems to be first line, try and get some psychological therapy. What can we do for our elderly housebound or care home population? Is there, are there any options really?
I think, well, I'm less certain about primary care based psychological treatments in that regard. I think there is some growing awareness of the need for flexibility that way. I also think at that level, sometimes we need to think a little bit differently around what we think term psychological interventions. Mm-hmm. So something like social prescribing, social inclusion, sort of including people with support workers or looking at those things. That's still psychological intervention, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Because actually at its heart, it's about humanity and interactions and trying to help somebody be supported.
Go back to the isolation and all the things we started with.
And those things are really important. So sometimes this notion of having to wall off psychological interventions as being done by specifically trained practitioners, here's your block of 6 weeks of CBT for loneliness. Do you know, that doesn't work, does it?
No.
So it's thinking about that broad brush of psychosocial interventions, and I think that's where the greater hope and greater scope is within that sort of the frail complex, housebound or sort of limited opportunities for getting out cohort. When you start to move up to the level where secondary care involved, the community mental health team, sort of nursing, occupational therapy interventions, and we can still link in with yourselves, can't we, around things like social prescribing and and sort of use of the third sector, Age UK, Alzheimer's Society, those sorts of different groups, those are important, and it's I suppose where I'm quite lucky working in crisis teams is I've got a lot of people that can help sort of enact that for me, whereas you poor GPs sat there sort of, okay, what do I do now? Who helps me get this sorted?
Where do we go? I'll come back to services at the end and pick your brains on that one a little bit. And if we do go down the prescribing line, I suppose what would be really useful sort of update for us working in the community is just thinking of, actually in terms of antidepressant choices in the elderly population, what would be the good first lines that you'd be thinking of, and how low to go with doses, how to titrate. This is a broad brush approach. Obviously, we've got to individualise it. Yeah. But
I suppose the prescribing guidance is similar to with the adult population. You'd start with your SSRIs and sort of work your way down the list, I suppose, depending on sort of tolerance and how someone responds to the medications. I think you do generally go a bit slower, but sometimes you can be too cautious with prescribing, especially with frailty. Myself and Nick have had conversations recently about some case examples that we've had where you're almost sort of you're afraid to prescribe because of various other conditions that somebody has, but actually by not prescribing you're not actually treating something that needs some
another
intervention.
Condition.
And you end up in this situation where somebody lives an awful life through fear of actually treating, at the risk of it could cause something from happening.
Of the SSRIs, any particular ones you'd go for or avoid in this population? Or
I suppose the risk is I'd be turning to sort of personal preference.
So nothing
SSRIs. I generally sort of following on from Nick because he's been
he's prevaricating because he's in front of his supervisor.
I generally steer away from things like paroxetine just because it's really short half life,
and it's got quite a high anticholinergic burden, I think, paroxetine,
And I think it, something like sertraline, for example, the SAD heart trial, which is probably getting on a bit itself now, showed sertraline to be effective and safe in heart disease, so that's one of the difficulties we find is you get an agitation effect at initiation sometimes, which you can get around. Citalopram, I worry a little bit that the QTC problem is overstated. And when you start to look at the evidence for trial data, there's good effect in older populations at doses above 20, and you can do an ECG
We see a lot of mirtazapine use in the care home population. I think people are tempted because of the sedative effect at the lower dose.
It's one of these where cardiovascular risk is a bit underrated there sometimes. No, I think we sometimes gloss over it, but with a bit of confirmation bias, like you say, with the sedation and the appetite and all the rest, it would be great. It's useful to remember that the sedative effect decreases as you increase the dose.
Yes.
As it becomes more antidepressant, it overrides the antihistamine effect. We do still use it, and people do find it of benefit. I suppose it's just making sure you don't ignore the fact that it's got cardiac and metabolic risk associated, risk with falls. Nightmares, hallucinations and hangover effect are also common, because the sedation can be quite delayed.
Right.
So I can find that an issue. That said, you could argue that trazodone is a bit of a muckier drug with cholinergic and adrenergic effects and postural drop and other things, but do I use it? Yeah, I do. And it is probably better for a sort of initial insomnia, sometimes at smaller doses, and it's maybe not the same go-to antidepressant, but it's one that I don't think we should be shy of. Again, it's that thing that Josh came back to, is that, yes, we've got risks. We've got some fears about adding treatment here, but we've got somebody who's suffering.
And perhaps the sedative effect of that is still safer than putting them on some hypnotics, some zopiclone or temazepam.
Yeah, so if you're going to end up on citalopram and zopiclone,
yeah,
is that better than mirtazapine?
Yeah.
And I suppose they're just different dilemmas, because if you think, well, the sleep problem's not too bad, and once we treat the depression, the sleep will improve, so...
Yeah.
In theory, so it's just trying to work through with people their choices, work through the balance, and by the time they darken our doors, they've usually been tried on quite a number of things anyway. So we're getting asked to go off piste a bit, aren't we? Really?
One thing with SSRIs that we often sort of think about is hyponatremia, and I don't know whether that's something that you end up stopping them. As a result of,
yep. In short,
I have to say I was looking at the medicines management guidance on this, and I wasn't aware that we're supposed to be checking a sodium according to that after a month of an SSRI in an elderly patient. I don't think that probably happens very often.
I would suggest it's patchy in terms of how it's done. We often look at it, and we often get hamstrung by it, because it gravely limits your options. For me, it often comes down to being sure it is the SSRI, and that's where that blood test around a month is really helpful, because if they're also on ramipril and omeprazole, which, you know,
that's
not uncommon, is it? Or they've got sort of shifts with related to kind of fluid compartment things, so they've got edema, they've been put on furosemide, benzofurum, thiazide, etc. Was it that? Was it the new drug? Because if it wasn't the sertraline, how do we manage that, and how do we look at things as alternatives? Because you start to get limited, broadly speaking, to things like mirtazapine, lefepramine, or even going back to MAOIs, sometimes with meclobamide can be.
If you in some having cohorts, a sodium drop,
is one of the options, which is a limiting but still quite good antidepressant. So it is a problem. It's not an insurmountable one.
It's good to be aware of.
But it does cause bruises to my forehead when they're...
And I think the final area I wanted to touch on, and it's a huge topic in itself, but just thinking about, particularly again in this population, suicidality, self-harm, just any thoughts between you on things we should be thinking about here, the significance of self-harm in this population and where to go a bit.
I think one of the sort of main risk groups are those people that first present no history of self-harm, no history of suicidal attempts, that suddenly turn up expressing these sorts of ideas, that they're generally quite a high-risk population there that need quite urgent intervention and looking at. Nick's already spoke about sort of the other high-risk area of people with depression and psychosis, looking at sort of data on sort of deaths and suicide. It's one of the ones that's up there as... high risk. As Nick said, we're looking in the trust at looking at our pathways about how we support and intervene with people with that condition. I think some people, it's sometimes hard, I think, to pick apart those in later life that have all the thoughts around their life naturally coming to an end versus suicidal thinking, and that, that can sometimes take quite a nuanced approach, I suppose, to understand what are the risks there. Is it somebody just considering sort of that their life's coming to an end, getting affairs in order, being prepared for when it does happen, versus somebody that's
accepting
taking
the reality versus
and you do get quite a lot of philosophical conversations in the office about that sort of cohort of, you know, is it a sort of suicidal preparation, or is it just actually getting everything in order and sort of sensible end of life planning?
And given the risks, if, you know, if we see self-harm, definite self-harm, I'm thinking that we would be thinking, let's call in the crisis team if we're worrying about significant suicidal risk. Can you just finish, maybe Josh, by just talking us through the services out there? We're all aware of the crisis team, but just a little bit about who's in the CMHT for the older adults and
yeah, so all the different teams
across the county
more or less have the same setup of, they usually have some form of psychiatrist cover, bit of psychology, it's quite a scarce resource, usually some senior nurses, occupational therapists, support workers, occupational therapy assistants, admin. Some teams have a bit of physio and pharmacy input as well. You generally have sort of a hierarchy of services, so within Derbyshire Healthcare, or your referrals generally go to the CMHT. They hold our single point of access. So even things that sort of people think of as crisis services would go through there and be sort of triaged by one of the clinicians in the team and sort of sent in the right direction, if you like. I suppose part of the rationale for that is sort of no respect to our sort of GP and primary care colleagues out there. Sometimes you get referrals through that say in crisis. And I suppose it's different thresholds of what crisis is.
Yeah.
You know, crisis in my mind and risk in my mind is a lot higher than that within a CMHT and that within a GP. So sometimes those referrals that come through that look like they're for us when in crisis services, when you get in touch with them, it's below sort of what our threshold is. So it's about finding the right level of response. And I suppose us sitting in secondary care are usually a good position to be able to make that call. So I suppose your first level in secondary care is your community mental health teams, your mental health helplines.
Mm-hmm.
They can sort of triage referrals and do treatment interventions, usually more of their sort of slower, steady approaches. From there, we have sort of our crisis teams, which are the next tier up, and mental health liaison teams. They're your sort of at risk of admission level. So there's my team, which is the very long-winded in-reach and home treatment team, not a name choice by myself, but what we're stuck with. So we cover sort of the functional mental health conditions. Not to say that we don't work with people with dementia as well, but if the crisis is around a functional condition, then they'll be under us.
Yeah.
And then we have the dementia rapid response team, which is the dementia crisis team.
That's helpful to know how that's split, because I've often been a bit unclear about those, the names of the services.
We work very closely together. So sort of, for example, in the High Peak and Dales, we're in the same big room, just different corners of the office. And then I suppose the next level down for that is hospital admission, where we have dementia wards and we have functional wards. And we're, at the moment, we're in the process of building a new healthcare facility for primarily just for over 65s with functional conditions, so
could
be ready in the summer this year, hopefully, which is good news. But as crisis teams, we also, for lack of a better word, gatekeep admissions as well. So we're the ones that sit there thinking, does this person need to go into hospital? What are we asking for that as an admission? Because one of the things, sort of a bit of advice that Nick gave me, apart from the many bits of advice, is usually get referrals for sort of two reasons. One, because somebody knows what needs doing and they can't do it themselves and need enhanced support.
Mm-hmm.
Or two, they don't know what needs to be done and they just need someone to help out.
But the bottom line for us is go through the CMHT, you'll triage it and you'll send it to the right place.
And I think with that process of triage, especially within in those windows within primary care where you know the person, and I believe that does still exist. Yeah, if you really are worried, and that part of that worry is, I know this person, and this is different, and this is changed, this is altered, is to be a dog with a bone about it.
Yeah.
Because we're like any other service. If you knock on the door in the right way, we'll let you in. But
just knowing that
yeah.
that little monkey on your shoulder telling you to worry.
Yeah.
Well, thank you both so much. There's lots we've gleaned from that, I'm sure. And been great to speak to you both.
Thank you.
So hopefully some useful reflections to take away once again, and maybe pop in your portfolio or CPD as well. I was looking at a recent report by the Centre for Mental Health, which was commissioned by Age UK, which talks about the sense of inevitability that can normalise poor mental health in the elderly and prevent help seeking. In fact, older people are less likely to be offered talking therapies, even though they actually have a higher than average recovery rate with them. So for those of us frustrated by the difficulties in accessing CBT and so on in our housebound patients, I thought it was really helpful to have Nick and Josh's thoughts on how we can reframe the use of things like befriending and activities through social prescribing as alternative positive forms of psychological intervention. There are things we can do for these elderly patients, and we should be doing them. So as always, this was the opinion of a couple of experts in the field. So in individual cases, do consider local and national guidance and use your clinical judgment. Next time, I'll be in conversation with Royal Derby geriatrician Jane Ude, talking all about falls in the elderly, a really useful update. So hope you'll join me then. But bye for now.
Conversations in Frailty. Thanks for listening.